While it may not feel like it sometimes, the future is not an inevitable destination, but something that is shaped by the trends, and these can be influenced if understood and responded to. At McCrindle, we're fascinated by the trends impacting the world around us. Our trends of 2024 tell a story of shifting perceptions, technological innovation, generational changes, and ultimately the unfolding future. Observing these trends helps to make informed predictions about the trends set to shape the year ahead. Two of our top trends for 2024 include community redefined and the grandparent economy. Hello, my name is Holly Schaaf. I'm stepping into the host role again today so that Ashley Fell, our beloved host, can be today's guest and help us unpack these two trends. So, hey, Ash, great to have you on as a guest today on the Future Report podcast.
It's great to have you, Holly, as the host. We have the pleasure, our listeners have the pleasure of listening to you be the host every now and then when I need to move into the guest seat. So we're excited today to be talking about our trends of 2024. You read it out in that introduction so eloquently, and we've talked about it on the podcast a couple of times already. But our trends of 2024 is a really important set piece for the year for our organization, kind of late into 2023, so the year before. We start kind of thinking and reflecting about all the conferences we've been a part of and all the studies we've done and all the research pieces to think about the year ahead and to think about the trends that are most relevant for most of our audience. So these trends, as you mentioned, kind of bring a combination of demographic changes and technological innovations and generational change, and really are an output, an outlet for us, if you will, to be able to kind of paint a picture of the future. And so we've already, because we're a few months now into 2024, we've been talking about them in our presentations, in our advisory sessions. We've got an infographic summary on our website. And we did a bit of, as I mentioned, a bit of a overview in one of the previous episodes of the podcast about a few of the trends. But there's so many insights that we gathered for these trends that we kind of wanted to profile some of them in their own episodes. So we did Superiority with Mark a few weeks ago. We've done Real Economy or Real Environment, I should say, and some of the other kind of population growth reckoning trends with Grant. So now you and I are talking about two really important ones today in Community Redefined and the Grandparent Economy. So delighted to be moving into the guest role and for you to kind of move into that host role that you've done a few times yes. And that you do so well today.
Thanks, Ash. It's a lot of fun. Delighted to have you in the guest seat because I know you have lots of wisdom to share and have had your hands so much in coming up with these trends, getting the research around them, writing it all up. So it's great to be able to hear some of your perspective and thoughts and sharing these insights. And like you mentioned, gave a great overview there. There's a bunch of trends that we've spoken on, touched on previously, but a couple we're really zooming in today is community redefined and the grandparent economy. So I think we just dive in. What do you think?
Sounds good. Let's do it.
Let's do it. Awesome. So we're going to start off with community redefined, Ash. And so could you please define to me and to our listeners this trend and how we came to include this as a top trend shaping the year ahead for 2024?
Yes, absolutely. So what I thought I would do is begin by just sharing point blank the small definition that we assigned to this on the infographic. So the TLDR summary, the too long didn't read summary, is... As more of our lives are lived online, people are finding new ways to meet the timeless need for human connection. We see as well the micro community trend emerging digitally and physically as a way for people to find genuine connection. So that's kind of our really brief summary. It's our two-sentence summary on the infographic where we have the eight trends, and we've got a little image on this infographic. I'll try and paint a picture for the listeners with my words. From on the left-hand side, we've got this kind of group of people gathering. Say there's like 15 of them. Then we've got a little arrow to like a iPhone or a smart device where you've got like a group chat, and then another arrow out of that to the right-hand side of just a couple of people on the younger generation side. And so what we're seeing and what we're trying to communicate with this particular trend is this context of increasing loneliness in this age where we aren't connecting in as traditional ways as previous generations did, where they would know their neighbours, where they would be involved in Rotary clubs and churches and sporting activities. Like, these things still exist, but the participation rate in them is kind of declining. So we were already talking about that pre-pandemic. Then COVID hits and locks us all into our homes. And, you know, that I think once in a generation black swan event combined with this trend of more people, especially younger people, moving towards online communities and connecting on social media platforms and group chats instead of going to the pub and having dinner with friends. You know, it's this idea that the context and the events and the technological transformation is kind of all merged to create what we've seen from our research, which is people not engaging in community as much. And then it's the idea that we are still needing community and we still want community and people desire it, and as humans we need it, and so it is being redefined and reimagined. And that's the kind of the trend. And one of the things that I guess we as in, you know, internal McCrindle advisory team were talking about in formulation of this was some of the language that people might have heard around the loneliness epidemic or the silent pandemic. So of course, when you think of about the term pandemic, you think COVID, you think COVID-19 and the time that shan't be named or thought too much about because it was not a great time for a lot of people.
No.
And I think this other term or this play on the word of this silent pandemic is we know from the health perspective, the impact of the pandemic and impact on our work and the future of work in remote and, you know, industry ceasing to exist for a while, live events, all of that, that big pause, that collective pause we had. But in light of that, now that we're back to the workplace in some cases and we're back to live events and we're communities back, there's still this silent pandemic where people, because of COVID and because of this technologically integrated world, are feeling more lonely. And it was really interesting. We kind of had this hypothesis. We were seeing a lot of other people talk about it. And so we decided to run some of our own research to investigate this. And it was really interesting. So we released these insights only a couple of weeks ago. We found that 3 in 5 Australians, so 59%, say that they often or sometimes feel lonely. So I think it's interesting if you even think about that for yourself, Holly, if I think about it, if our listeners think about it, would you group yourself in that category that you often or sometimes feel lonely? So that's across the board. But then when we segmented this particular insight by generation, which we always do, it was actually Gen Z. It was those in their late teens, and anyone who is in their 20s today is classified as Gen Z. So they're the most likely generation to say that they feel lonely, with 71% saying they often or sometimes feel lonely. So 7 in 10 Gen Zs, which is fascinating. I mean, it's not positive. It's not great that people are feeling lonely, but it's interesting to hypothesize why. And I think as people get older, they're actually less likely to say that they often or sometimes feel lonely. So 71% of Gen Z say that, compared to 69% of Gen Y, 58% of Gen X, and 40% of baby boomers, which, I don't know, I was quite surprised by that, because I would have thought the older someone gets, the more likely maybe they are to experience the loss of someone or people close in their life. Older people are often quite socially isolated, but it's the younger generation. It's 7 in 10 Gen Zs who say that they often or sometimes feel lonely. So that's different to saying I rarely feel lonely every now and then. This is kind of pretty regular occurrence. And so I think it's just interesting. I mean, this whole trend has come about, I think, because of this change in even work environments. I imagine if you're a remote worker, if you're used to, you know, back in the day, you used to go into the office because it was mandated, you would get that regular social interaction 5 days a week if you're full-time, just because you had a job. Whereas today, with the remote environment, if people are working remotely, if they're not engaging in community, they are more likely to be socially isolated. There's less involvement in community groups and associations. People are just busier because the cost of living crisis that we're in. We have this increase in dual income households. So people are living busier lives. They're more time poor. So they're not able to maybe engage in community groups as often. Maybe people were involved in community groups before the pandemic and they haven't gone back to those groups because they kind of dissolved and then all got too hard, and it requires some discipline to do that. So all of this is to say we've got this increase in loneliness. But the combat of that is people are engaging more in kind of these micro communities, these group chats, these online forums where they still get social connections, still get social interaction, and they almost become like these group chats or WhatsApp groups become like the primary way for meaningful social engagement, as opposed to, as I mentioned, like more traditional forms where it was in person, IRL kind of meetups in real life, you know. So I think it's fascinating. I mean, Holly, you're a Gen Z yourself. I'm a couple of years older than you as a Gen Y, so we do fit into different generations. But do you have any reflections? Were you surprised by the fact that it's younger generations who are more likely to say that they are experiencing feelings of loneliness?
Yeah, no, great question, Ash. And I think it's interesting. I think I'm equally surprised and not surprised. I think in the sense of being surprised, I would have absolutely agreed. I think you mentioned before your hypothesis around even, you know, older generations potentially losing loved ones more so at that age. You know, you would naturally think that with that comes up maybe a higher percentage of loneliness. And that's what's so cool about the research. I know you've mentioned before, it either confirms or disagrees with the hypothesis that you have. And so how I would have 100% seen it also going in that direction. You know, maybe the less people you may physically have around you as you grow in age, the more lonely that you become. And so I think in that sense, it really does surprise me, especially when you look at, you know, like how Gen Z and Gen Alpha, that, you know, the emerging generation are, you know, arguably some of the most globally connected, you know, generations in terms of what they have access to through social media and through, you know, all of these different platforms. And so I think that's where it actually turns to not becoming too much of a surprise, is that, you know, we are, as Gen Zs, so globally connected, have so much access to people from anywhere around the world, just through our smartphone, through TikTok, through Instagram. But it's interesting how much these platforms have actually replaced that in-person physical connection. And you mentioned it and highlighted it great before, that in a lot of senses, people are choosing to opt for these things instead of going and out to the pub with their friends. They would prefer to maybe be inside in a group chat, maybe sending each other TikToks or that sort of sharing entertainment and connection in that way. And so it is almost a bit ironic to look at a cohort that is so globally connected and so, you know, has 1,000 friends on Facebook, 2,000 Instagram followers, and, you know, it looks like they're engaging regularly in connection and community. But at the same time, it kind of, the statistics clearly go to show that there is something more than what meets the eye, and that maybe these maybe social internet forms of social connection are not really filling that human void, or I guess not even void, but human need, I guess, for connectivity, for that community, for that connection. Maybe those sort of things can really only come from in-person meetups and activities and community groups. Not to say that we shouldn't have any sort of connectivity online. Of course, that's important and plays a part, but it is interesting to see that maybe that isn't everything and isn't all that we need.
Yeah, it's so true. And I think, like you mentioned, you know, when you look at and you think about young people or people in their late teens or 20s, you think that, and I imagine a lot of people who are of an older generation today would think back and go, yeah, that was the most social life stage, because you've got more time, you've got more energy, maybe you don't have as much cash behind you, so it's cheap coffees instead of expensive wines out at night or whatever it might be like. But it's that idea that it is a really social life stage. And then as you go through different seasons of life, as you get older, it does become maybe a little bit more isolated, whereas the research is the inverse of that, where it's the older someone is, the less likely they are to say that they feel lonely. So like you said, it's fascinating just how, and a little bit ironic, that the most connected generation are feeling the most isolated. And so, yeah, I think it does point to the fact that human connection, human interaction face-to-face is somewhat irreplaceable. And I mean, it's still positive, I think, that we're seeing this rise in micro communities. That's not a bad thing. We're not saying WhatsApp groups and the internet is all bad, but we're just saying here, and we're seeing here, that maybe it can't equate to that. And I actually remember doing some research about this, or even just hearing some insights from someone during the pandemic, where it's kind of like a Zoom meeting where it's on a screen, and it's still, you know, during the pandemic when we were in lockdown, internet connectivity, Zoom, Microsoft Teams, whatever the platform was, like, thank goodness we had those, because it did enable us to connect. And that is important, but it's so different, like, when you're in a meeting on a screen compared to when you're in a meeting in the room, because even it's kind of like 2D on a screen, whereas in the room you've got different senses, like you can smell and touch and see, whereas when you're on screen you kind of just see, and it's not as memorable and it's not as kind of a shared experience. It's kind of like, oh, it's more transactional, whereas oftentimes it's those meetings or those trips with friends or where things happen that you didn't expect, and then you're laughing and then it's a shared moment of connection. So it's 100%. All these things that we might not realize we don't need. That we realize we do need. So yeah, it's fascinating.
No, it is fascinating. And I think you'd appreciate hear me bringing in the word tension, because I know you love attention, and seeing that things don't have to be black and white, one or the other. It can be both. And I think you've raised that well here, you know, that there is place for both, that physical connectivity, being, you know, with someone tangibly, you can hug them if you like, or, you know, there's that more of maybe that nonverbal communication is being seen as well, more so than behind a screen. But then at the same time, I think back to during lockdown, there were things that I was able to be a part of through Zoom, for example, that I would have never been able to be a part of physically. I know my best friend actually got married during the pandemic, and I was the maid of honor in the wedding, for example, and I actually wasn't able to leave Australia and come back, so I had to stay here. And so I was able to be a part through Zoom, which if we didn't have platforms like that, it wouldn't, you know, how much more challenging it would have been to be able to be a part of that day and still feel like I was there when I wasn't there physically. And so there is such amazing things that do come from having those points of connection virtually and having those kind of community or touch points like that. But I guess it's important to have both. We don't need to throw one out and have the other. It's kind of, holding both together. But I know you mentioned and highlighted there this idea of micro communities. I know that's a part of the trend. And so what significance, Ash, do these micro communities hold in actually addressing the societal search for meaningful connections? And how are they reshaping our social fabric?
Yeah, it's they're reshaping it. And yeah, even though we said, you know, they maybe can't replace that, the beauty of meeting someone in person and all that experience can bring to a relationship, to a connection, to a meeting, they still have a place. And these micro communities can be digital in the form of group chats. I think about my husband, actually. He is part of a run club, which everyone in the office knows about because I talk about it all the time, because it's such a big part of his life. And it's been really amazing for him to, I think, discover that during the pandemic and to build relationships with these, it's like it's a men's run club and they focus on men's mental health and running kind of as an antidote to loneliness and social isolation. So he's got this physical run club, but they've got all these like subgroups within this run club, and they've all got like, it's like a camping group chat of the run club, and then it's like a swimmers group chat, and then a cyclist one. I'm like, his phone's always pinging. I'm like, how many group chats do you have? And it was interesting because like we literally asked this in like one of these surveys where it's like people are engaging in more and more group chats online. And it's this idea that there are these kind of micro communities that people are really engaging with. And I think it's a fascinating kind of world that we're moving to. So it is that digital group chat, online chat, where it's not even like organizing a time to hang out. It's sending memes. And we've got a few group chats even within our team at McCrindle where we send like experiences and funny things or stories or voice messages. So it is building connection. It's just in a smaller, different way. So it's digital. And then it's also physical as well, in terms of, I guess, this return to local. We saw that during the pandemic where people were investing more in their local cafes and smaller communities because we couldn't gather in large arenas anymore. Although having said that, I mean, more recently, I was one of the lucky few who attended a Taylor Swift concert.
Yes.
Iconic. But I couldn't take the social researcher hat off. Like I can't take it off. It's just a full on part of me now.
Yes.
But it was interesting because I was talking to people that was sitting around, and we were just reflecting even before she came on around how significant it is and how these sold out stadiums, like because we haven't had them for so long, do we crave those in-person experiences more where you're experiencing something with like 60,000 other people and there's this buzz and this energy, you know? And so anyway, that was interesting. But I guess this micro community inverse trend is smaller, more local, counter trend to this big globalization shift. So we've got that kind of idea of micro communities filling that gap. We also asked in some of our research around this trend what people are doing more of than they did 3 years ago and what they're doing less of compared to 3 years ago. It was really interesting to see that 45% of people are more likely to say that they're well, they're likely to say that they're sending more encouraging messages, like text messages or voice messages potentially today than they were 3 years ago. And 36% are connecting in private group chats more today than they did 3 years ago. However, the inverse of that, which is also interesting, is that 27% say they're doing it less, which it's almost this idea that we have so many group chats, like my husband, where it's like, you almost get like group chat fatigue.
Yeah.
You have to silence a couple. You're like, because the constant notifications like come sometimes can get too much. I know that about you, Holly, as well. You get a bit overwhelmed with too many
group chats. That is very true. You just leave those ones unread until one day when you decide to deal with them all.
Yeah. But it's like, but it's a sign of this trend that's happening for many people. Mm. So we're good. We're doing that more on average today. But we're also 31% of people said that they're not meeting up for coffee as much as they were 3 years ago. Mm. 35% said that they're not going out for dinner as much as they were 3 years ago. And 36% are gathering at a local park less than they did 3 years ago.
Right.
So it's interesting. It's kind of this rise in sending text messages and group chats and a slight decline in actually going out and meeting up with people, whether it's coffee or dinner or a local park. So I think for us, what does all this mean for someone listening? I think first of all, on a really personal level, it's to like check in with yourself. That sounds weird to say, but like think about how you feel. Are you feeling lonely? Maybe reach out to people in your life. The second part I would say, again, like quite personal advice for other people listening is check in with the people around you in your life, especially those Gen Zs, and just make sure that they're feeling connected, because that plays a huge role in our satisfaction, happiness, mental health, experience of life. And I think for just maybe business leaders, I would say probably expect to hear more about loneliness, social isolation, changes to how people find and experience community in the year ahead, because these are big conversations that aren't going to be resolved really quickly. And we even, part of what we saw and why we knew this kind of trend, or our hypothesis of this trend was important for this year, was because of the surveys we did and the research we did, but also it is gaining global attention. We know that Britain appointed the world's first loneliness minister in 2018. And since then, Japan followed in 2021, and Australia's first loneliness awareness week occurred in 2023. So there's just more attention being given to this topic, because it does have big implications for people. So yeah, it's an important trend, a bit of a sobering one, but hopefully one that even us shedding some light on it might be able to help people feel less lonely, which would be a great thing.
Yeah, absolutely. You outlined that so well, Ash, and even those practical takeaways at the end there, it's so important, because it doesn't just impact, yourself, the people around you, but there is real, business implications for it, leadership implications for it. Every sphere of life, these stats and these insights are actually very relevant too. And so I love what you've highlighted there on both a personal and a professional note. It is really important to really take note of this one this year and the way it may impact the years ahead. And so we'll just move along onto the second trend, which we wanted to chat about today, which is the grandparent economy. I know we touched on this one. You and Grant had a bit of a conversation a couple weeks ago on the podcast, where you touched over a few trends, and this was one of the ones you looked into a little bit. But we thought we would give it a bit more attention, dive in a little bit deeper into these insights here. So we're exploring the significant impact in this trend of baby boomers on the economic landscape. That's kind of the overarching summary of what's kind of going on with this one. But could you shed light on the pivotal role in wealth transfers and how they actively contribute to shaping the financial dynamics of 2024?
Yes, absolutely. So this one, as we kind of outlined earlier in the episode, we are trying to hit a few different mega trends, what we call mega trends, in these eight trends that we have formulated. So from demographics to economics to social to generational to technological. So this is really hitting, I think, a few, economic being one, with the word economy in the title, the grandparent economy.
naturally.
But also I think it does play into the social trends and the generational trends, and it does relate to community and how grandparents are playing a more important role today in communities, in families. We've got a generation of grandparents today who are living longer in life, which means there's this trend, what we call down aging, where it's this idea that people are at an older age behaving like younger. So a 70-year-old today is behaving and acting like a 60-year-old a couple of decades ago because we've got this longevity boom. They're in the workforce later in life because they're living longer. They're more likely to be active travelers and participants in the workforce than previous generations who might have retired at 55 or 65. Now you've got people working later for a range of different reasons. So this grandparent economy trend, if I read out the little summary on our infographic, it says, and it describes the significant impact of baby boomers on the economic landscape, showcasing their pivotal role in wealth transfers as they actively contribute to and shape the financial dynamics of this era. So contrary to the okay boomer trend that a lot of people used a few years ago among Gen Z particularly and Gen Y too and the millennials, to dismiss the boomers, they're actually a really important generation to be thinking about, to be, I think, recognizing as well. And that's kind of what was our goal in this particular trend. And yeah, we profiled them in our trends of 2024. I mean, I've used this, I think before on the podcast, this fact that the baby boomers in Australia comprise less than a quarter of the population as a population demographic, but they own more than half the nation's private wealth. And it's not fair, of course, to say that every single baby boomer is cashed up and well off because their assets have appreciated over time. But stereotypically, a lot of this generation who invested into property when property was only three times the average annual income have benefited from the last few decades. So a lot of the younger generations are feeling the pinch of these tough economic times. And I'm not saying that baby boomers aren't feeling the pinch because everyone across all generations is feeling the rising cost of living. But if you've got an asset in a house sometimes or a paid off asset or savings, they might be benefiting from the current challenges that younger generations are facing with regards to the economy. And so faithful loyal listeners, shout out to those people who are listening and who have listened to this podcast over a few different seasons and episodes, might recall that last year we did an episode about this generation of grandparents kind of stepping in and helping with regards to the cost of their grandchildren's education. And that was, for us, I think, a bit of a catalyst for this trend. I mean, we also wanted to, as we said, acknowledge the baby boomers and any other generation, maybe their younger Gen X grandparents or older builders today who are grandparents. But there is this amazing generation in grandparents who do have a lot of wealth behind them. That wealth will be transferred over the coming years. And so we know that from, you know, Bureau of Statistics information. And we actually wanted to investigate this as well in a survey. And these insights are fascinating. I know because I shared them at our virtual event. We asked this question, which of the following have you ever received from your grandparents? So we asked this across all Australians. So you've got younger Gen Zs who are in their 20s today who are thinking about their current grandparents who are alive, who are maybe involved in their life or not, who are giving them a leg up, whether it might be help for travel or a place to live. And then we also asked that of the current generation of grandparents who are reflecting back to when they were young and getting help from their grandparents in a different economic kind of climate. So it was interesting to see that 16% of Gen Z today say that they have received financial support for overseas travel from their grandparents. That compares to just 1% of baby boomers.
Wow.
So Gen Z today is 16 times more likely than the baby boomers to say that they had received financial support for overseas travel. We also saw that we see today that 12% of Gen Z have received financial support to buy a home from their grandparents compared to just 2% of baby boomers. And this one's really fascinating. 20% of Gen Z today have lived with their grandparents for free or for reduced rent. That's one in five Gen Zs compared to just 5% of baby boomers. So it's this idea that the granny flat on the family property is not for the grannies. It's for the Gen Zs in this kind of, or the Gen Ys, or the millennials. Yeah. Like it's not just Gen Z, but it's this idea that grandparents are giving help financially, particularly to their grandkids or kids. And we know that grandparents do so much from other studies around, maybe not financially, but they provide childcare. They do pick up and drop offs with kids. They might make meals. Like they're helping in so many ways. So we, And we had this play on words. Instead of the bank and mum and dad, it's the bank of nan and pop. And of course, they are so much more than just financial support. There's emotional support, yes, and they play an important role. But we also wanted to acknowledge that economic role and this powerhouse that is the baby boomers, and kind of synonymously kind of grouping them as grandparents in this particular trend. So, yeah, as I mentioned, it is an economic trend, but they're also playing a huge role in community. And I think what we were talking about before, I think younger generations, myself included, have a lot to learn about how older generations do community. And they're more likely to be isolated and in an isolated season of their life, but they're less likely to say they feel lonely. So what can we learn from them about how they're plugging into community, how important, you know, interaction is, where they're going for that? It's an interesting kind of trend, and one that's got a few different layers.
Yeah, that's fantastic. I'm glad we were able to dive into that a little bit more as well, because there is such interesting and, I know, surprising to me at least, insights there in terms of even what you highlighted there with Gen Z being 16 times more likely to receive, was it travel, like travel support, that sort of thing.
Yeah,
it's just so wild. Just makes me want to call up my grandparents as well and just thank them for everything.
I thought you were gonna say call them up and ask some trip money.
Said, speaking of which,
very good.
Being grateful takes priority. It really does just make me reflect on how fantastic and important grandparents are in our lives. Like you mentioned, obviously, in this way where there is an economic and a financial imprint. But like you mentioned, there's actually so much to be learned about their life experience, but also the way they do community. That is such a good point you bring up, how they might physically be more isolated than other stages of their life, but are not saying that they feel as lonely as younger generations. There is definitely things to be learned there from that. And so, fantastic insights, Ash. It is so wonderful to have you as a guest on your own podcast and just be able to hear a bit more from you about these trends that, like I mentioned, you were able to work so closely on and so in depth with. So thank you so much for the chat today and for sharing your wonderful wisdom and these great insights.
Oh, my pleasure. It's so fun to be in the guest chair, and on behalf of me and all our listeners, Holly, thank you for being host today. You do an exceptional job as always.
Thank you, Ash. It is truly a delight and a privilege. If you would like to stay up to date with McCrindle's latest insights, you can subscribe to the podcast, follow us on social media, or head to McCrindle.com. So as always, thank you again for listening, and bye for now.